Okay. John, have you got a mascot?
Well, regular viewer may remember I recently wrote my first erotic novel, Deep Clean.
I remember Deep Clean.
Deep Clean, yes.
Deep Clean was very erotic.
A very sexy book about cleaning. He emptied his hot white load into the basket. Boy, what that is. It went very well. Sold quite a few copies. No film deal, which, I'll be honest, has pissed me off. So I've written Deep Clean 2 under the rim. This is the one. This is going to go to Hollywood. We've got Kim and Aggie lined up for the lead roles. I'll be honest, I've just ripped off the storyline from 50 Shades of Grey and I've just made it about cleaning. So, would you like me to read you some?
I'd love, yeah, an extract.
What's happening here is our wannabe journalist, Dimitri Magnesium.
Great name!
Yeah. He's a wannabe journalist and cleaning fanatic, and he's managed to get the big interview with the CEO of SIF. Presbyteria Beige. You've got to go with a religion, then a colour.
Presbyterian Beige. Rather than Christian Grey.
If a formula works, stick to it. So, hi, I'm here for the interview. My name is Dimitri, but you can call me Dimit. Go through, Dimitri. She's expecting you, says the receptionist out of his wide-open mouth. You don't get many Dimitris from Lancashire, he cackles. Crumbs of egg sandwich falling from his mouth onto the desk. Dimitri shivers as he wonders how much bacterial buildup there must be in the recessed lettering of his keyboard. I wish I had a tool small enough to penetrate those dark recesses. Advancing on the door, he lowers the sleeve of his cardigan to avoid touching the handle with his bare skin. No sooner is he close enough for his breath to mist up the glass, it slides wide open and he forces himself deep inside. A Saniglide 3000 with a hermetic air barrier. Nice. Presbyteria is waiting for him on the other side of the door, and before he knows what's happening, she grabs his stiff, sweating palm and pumps it up and down, up and down, up and down. Does this make you uncomfortable, she asks. No, he lies. She howls with laughter and points to the container of hand sanitizer mounted on the wall. Cream yourself off and we'll get started.
That is quite something. Have you got a mascot this week?
Well, not so much a mascot, but I thought you would label Josh and I as nerds. I thought if I was organizing Josh's stag do, this is probably what I'd do. So I thought we'd go like full stag on it.
You made a quiche.
Well, people think I'm not fun, so I've brought in some booze. This is my
guys. What is that?
That's Canund rum.
Let's.
And then.
Couple of shot glasses, and any time we get a nine-letter word, look out, ladies.
So if you get a nine-letter word, you're going to do a shot of rum?
Oh, yes, mate.
OK. John, have you got a mascot?
Well, it's more of a pitch, really. I'm after getting out of this game, Jimmy. I've been in it too long. Getting jaded. But what I want is a piece of that sweet, sweet cartoon comic book hero action. So here are my new comic book heroes. So this is Scared of a Spider-Man. This is a man who got bitten by a spider, but instead of anything good happening, he absolutely shit himself. And since then has become so scared of spiders that he's built a giant pint glass that he lives inside. He's got sick of putting them on the spiders. He thought, cut out the middleman. And he's got a little telly in there, a little chair and his mug. He's having a smashing time.
Scared of a Spider-Man.
This is Pedant Man. So he just goes around correcting people all the time. That's his catchphrase there. It's an apostrophe. What he says when he's at the market and he's got his arch nemesis, his bad grandma. And this is the final one, the visible man. Ooh. So, he's able to penetrate any party or group like that. Not because he's invisible, people just ignore him. These aren't all drawn from experience, but this is just like, say, for example, there was a party and there was a lot of people in there, and someone was there who, you know, afterwards, they wouldn't have even known he was fucking there.
John's comic book heroes, everyone. What have you got?
Look at me if you're going to talk to me.
All right, how many letters?
I'm going to go for a 9.
Okay, John, you're 9.
You know, when you put a spirit into a glass, in the olden days, they would say you were a pourist instead of a barman, so you poured the beer.
You haven't got a 9.
After do you want a shot or not? Because you're ruining my stag do, mate. After you pouristed the beer, they'd say you really pouristed that well.
Susie, can you have pouristed?
Oh, so sadly, not. No. Oh. I can't even be a pourist.
OK, 7 points to both teams. John, have you got a mascot?
Yes. I thought it would be nice to catch up with some of the correspondence that we get on the show. We get a lot of tweets sent in, and some of them are mean. And I know, Sean, you're not on Twitter, so I thought it would be nice for you to understand some of the sort of witty banter that goes back and forth.
Thank you.
They're not all horrible, I have to say. This is the first one coming from Smiling Axolotl. The way the other people on Countdown treat you makes me genuinely sad, to be honest. That's lovely, isn't it?
They're genuine, aren't they?
These are genuine, yeah.
What, and they post these big in a big envelope?
Yeah. Big stamp. And this one is for all of us. You all need to have a long look at yourselves and think about the responsibility we have here. This came in from Andrew Pickford 5, my favourite band. sorry, but this programme has spoilt the original Countdown.
Yes!
Poor bastard. And look, 11 in the morning. Oh. He slept on that. No. This one's serious. Now, you have to accept when, like myself, you're one of the edgy comedians. I say a lot of things. Sometimes you say something, and I know when I've done it, I've said something pretty controversial. It's pissed people off. So I said something that upset Victoria. Switched off 8 out of 10 cats due to John Richardson's unnecessary comments about kittens.
Whoa.
Not at all funny. And she's gone straight to the bigwigs. Not walking around.
What did you say about kittens?
I think someone had a kitten on and I said that they eat birds. And I think Victoria has taken umbrage with that fact. She probably switched over to watch a nice, you know, Attenborough documentary where a gazelle gets ripped to shreds by 4 lions.
You don't expect kittens to be slagged off on 8 out of 10 cats.
No.
That's probably why she tuned in. She was confused.
Well, I suggest you might enjoy a show called 10 out of 10 cats.
You can be ruthless sometimes.
Sit down, Victoria. You've been served. Do you want a towel? Because you just got rinsed.
You know, if you responded to her in the way that Cardi B might, you'd say something like, "How you gonna suck your man's dick with my name in your mouth?" Yes.
What camera am I on? So, hey, Victoria.
Go on.
Come on, John, you can do this.
Yo, Victoria, how are you going to suck all the d***s?
With a fruit pastel in your mouth.
With a fruit pastel in your mouth.
Yeah. John Sweet, everyone. Yeah. What have you got, John?
9.
OK, Kathy.
5.
5. Well, let's hear your 5.
Gripe.
John, you're 9?
Well, when Jimmy... When you write with a pencil, you are a graphiter, but if you write on someone, that person is the graphitee. Nine, please. Nine, please. Thirsty work.
Graphitee.
There's graphitize, graphitic, graphitization, graphology, but no graphitee.
OK, so no shot for John and 5 points to Cathy. John, have you got a mascot?
Well, sort of, Jimmy. People always... No, they don't. Sometimes people talk to me. And what they say is, oh, but is your house full of old teapots and countdown prizes? Well, it is, actually, and it's beginning to piss me off. So if you don't mind, cos we've done so many of these shows, I'm just bringing back some of the prizes I've won that I just frankly have no use for. So I've brought in me a countdown bag, and frankly, you can have some of these things back. So in the bag, I've got me, well, these countdown boxer shorts. I'll be honest, I've ridden these absolutely within an inch of their life. They make me itch. Anyway, don't want them anymore, you keep them. Countdown basketball, won that a few episodes ago. I'll tell you now, the Venn diagram of people who are good at countdown and basketball is two circles. Now, this, I won this a while back, the countdown ladder, was for helping me get to things because I'm small. So it goes even bigger than that. Oh, it's heavier than it was earlier. You'd think they'd be lightweight, wouldn't you, them? But no, I don't need my countdown ladder. Whoa! And this I won, the old countdown bowling ball. Do you remember that? I actually decided I might keep this. So, are you ready? I mean, this guy got, because of the height of this, you can only get a six-year-old in there. So, are you ready to catch, Cecil? You all right? Somewhere in here, series three, I think, I put it in there. I can't find it. My old dignity was in there. I had dignity. It was...
Oh, that's got to hurt, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Oh. What have you got?
Well, I think I've got seven.
Cathy?
Six.
John?
Nine.
Josh, what have you got?
I'm so confident in John that I'm going to go with a two.
Two of the nine. John?
You're actually going to kick yourself, Sean. You're so nearly there. It's how do you get out in the event of a fire? You go through the fire doors. How do you get into a restaurant? Through the dine doors.
The dying doors, of course. Dying doors. Is it dying doors?
It's not there.
Okay, so that's 7 points to Sean. Okay, John, have you got a mascot?
Yes. Well, there comes a time for all comedians at some point to accept their fate and step back from the dog-eat-dog world of adult entertainment. I am writing a children's story. So, having had a child, I've looked into what kids like, and I commissioned studies to try and find a character kids could really relate to, something brand new, something they'd never seen before. And I've written this book called Salty Sow, which is an entirely brand new character I've come up with. My studies came back and said kids like pigs with names that sound like they've been seasoned. So...
Salty Sow, you say.
Salty Sow.
Independently.
Totally brand new.
Do you think of any other seasonings for it?
There's Horseradish Harry is another character in the... and obviously, when we go global, there's Wasabi Willy. Piri Piri Pete. This is for the UK market, Salty Sow. I've modelled the father on myself. I find that what you don't realise until your kids start watching these programmes is how heavily their behaviour is influenced by the characters they see on telly. So my daughter learned no and pushing something away from these little pricks. So this is a book all about sort of positive role models for kids. So this is a classic story. It starts on the couch. Look at that chaos there. Salty Sow is sitting quietly with Daddy Sow. Are we going to have fun, Daddy? Yes, we are, Salty. We're going to re-alphabetize your books. We're going to have a cracking afternoon. Is that all, Daddy? No. We're going to be even more fun than that. We're going to go around your bedroom, noticing how storage efficiency can be improved. What shall we do after we've sorted the new storage solutions, Daddy? Well, we'll celebrate downstairs with a glass of water and a dry cracker. My issue with a lot of these kids' stories is the way they end. So what happens in most of these? Someone says something mildly amusing and they all fall on the floor and laugh at the same time, which, as one of this country's leading comedians, I've got to tell you, has very rarely happened. I'm this funny 24/7, and I'll be honest, my wife, if she rolls around on the floor, she's very rarely with laughter. Mostly, it's more sort of hair-pulling, how has my life become this way experience.
You're trying for another, are you?
Wife? Can you imagine if I was the one that left? No, she's Salty. So obviously with Salty being a pig, if you flick to the end, these end a little bit more graphically, and at the end of every episode, they're killed and eaten. So she's saying there, Daddy, why are we in a sandwich? And he's saying, because, Salty, there are some assholes who still eat meat. Welcome to the fucking world.
Josh, what have you got?
Five.
Five, OK, and then John?
Nine!
You're nine, John?
Well, Jimmy, I do a lot of building work on the weekends. I'll knock through something like that. And when you're putting a beam in a house, you can't just put it in, you've got to obey the beam rules. And that's it, beam rules.
Susie, beam rules is in there, right?
Ready?
Yeah, it's in.
You can't lie to me.
I did try. I thought you could have a drink and then I could tell you.
I genuinely believed you.
I did.
John, have you got a mascot?
There's a lot of holidays in this country, frankly too many. People waste them with their family, let's be honest. Nobody wants to. Nobody wants an extra day off. You suddenly find you've got one, you're all in the same house. You can't say, do you know what, I've got some shit to catch up on if you don't mind. So you waste it. Not my new day. I'm launching Admin Day. It's a movable feast, you book it in whenever you want. You tell your family, you tell your friends. Nobody's allowed to contact me on this day. So, Admin Day, or as it's officially known, St. Ryman's Day. St. Ryman is the patron saint of admin. You nominate your Admin Day, and the most exciting part of Admin Day is the month leading up to Admin Day, where you get your Adminvent Calendar. I think that went fine. Yeah. You pop this on just above your kid's bed.
Are you a little bit out of breath?
I'm all right. I had a hernia anyway. And running up to Admin Day, you open up your little Admin Vent calendar each day and you pull out a piece of stationery you might need. Your highlighter. Everyone uses a highlighter once, don't they? And then you highlight it across ink, it gets dirty, you put it in the bin. You've got rubbers in there, of course, both kinds. Sometimes the excitement of admin overtakes. Important to be safe. You want some stationery? Might help with the show. You want a pen?
Yeah, man. Oh, no, I don't. Very clever. Yeah.
And we've reached the end of the bit now, and the moment that I have to contemplate putting that thing back down again.
With a hand.
Yeah, thanks.
Sean, what have you got?
Gonads.
how many letters?
Six.
OK, Kathy?
Gonads.
How many letters, Kathy?
Six.
Six, OK. Josh?
Six.
I think I know what you've got.
Two of them, mate. John?
9.
OK, let me just check in with Josh.
Let's go, Nads.
John, you're 9.
When you break up with someone who's into kinky sex, you are sado-exing.
Sado-exing, Susie, that's a word in the dictionary, isn't it?
Pretty I love sure. this job. It's just got sadomasochism, quite boringly. Well, not boringly, but, you know. No, it's not there, John. Sorry.
So, 6 points to both teams for Gonads. John, have you got a mascot?
I've noticed over recent time period a rise in the sort of sale of these sort of things. I get given a lot of them, sort of witty messages written on bits of wood that are supposed to make you feel better about life. And what really annoys me about them, they sort of hint at quite bleak comedy. That when you analyse them, the basic message is that men go into sheds and masturbate quietly on their own. And women just clock watch until they can drink enough gin to escape their miserable lives. So I thought, in these troubled times, why not get in on that market? And my messages are slightly pithier, they're slightly more to the point, and they're all written in an ecological angle on things that I've found washed up on my local beach at Blackpool. Some of them aren't finished yet, so this is one I'm still working on. It says, people who only regret the things they didn't do have never called their partner a... this one is...
I had one of those weeks, are you?
More and more, would you believe?
Best to keep it private, it's my advice, mate.
This is a number of things I've gathered from the beach, and this is both an ecological message and it's a message about trying to find love in our times, and it's entirely made from condoms that have washed up. I've written it, spells out in the condoms. You can see that. There are actually fewer fish in the sea than you think. And that's both a message about the fleeting nature of love, which is why I've used the condoms as the medium for this piece. And, of course, because the condoms are choking the wildlife of our seas. So it's both a literal message about the fact that if you're gonna use a condom, and you absolutely should, just... And I don't really know what you do with them.
Swallow them.
Swallow them.
Swallow them. Straight away after.
Like a chewy oyster. It's incredible the things you find on the beach, and I can't believe the things people throw away. So this is my biggest piece, and this is a sort of wider message about the time we live in. This is called Time, and this is something I found on Blackpool Beach last week. nobody claimed it. I watched for about an hour. Nobody came. And I think it hasn't moved, so I assume it's for sale. So... 50 quid or something for that, if anyone's interested.
So what does it say on it?
It says, we are all. That's the...
We are all. It's quite beautiful.
Oh, he's alive. I thought you were... Worst stag do ever.
Claudia.
Hello.
You've worked with Mary Berry.
Yeah.
Now, is she good company? Do you get on well?
Brilliant. You would love her.
Are there cooking tips that she's imparted to you?
Apparently, stuff just needs to be seasoned. That's the key. Salt and pepper.
Good enough.
Worcester sauce. Yeah, it's good.
You learn.
I don't know
you
what.
Salt
for.
And pepper.
Well, but Mary is such a genius. She can tell you something and she knows when it's been seasoned. Not at the end, it needs to be at the beginning.
Oh, she's like a fucking Jedi, isn't she? You're telling me Mary Berry knows what salt tastes like.
I'll give you a cooking tip while we're here.
Go on.
Go on.
If you're chopping garlic, wash your hands with cold water, not hot. And then it doesn't cook the smell of the garlic onto your fingers and it washes it off. You don't smell that garlic for the rest of the day.
I've got a little tip. If you're cooking with chilies and chopping them up, don't stick your finger up your arse.
Oh, I can add to that. Don't stick it up anyone else's arse either. Why are you not on a cooking show, John. You love cooking.
I know. Well, I don't get the offers, do I?
Is it because the health and safety chat at the beginning would last the whole show?
Key information. Not going to tell you the baking tray tip now either.
Oh, so come on!
Sit on that and swivel. You're already so old. When you've jizzed on the baking tray, don't lick it or something.